Hello everyone, welcome to Affairs Cloud. The Consumer Protection Act, which is considered as the Magna Carta in the field of consumer protection, has been amended in 2019. The reason we are discussing about this is because it has come into effect recently. So in this video, we'll be taking a look at the Consumer Protection Act of 2019 in detail. So as we just noted, the reason we are talking about the 2019 Consumer Protection Act now is because it has come into effect from the 20th of July 2020. And it replaces the previous Consumer Protection Act that was issued back in 1986. Now, the definition of a consumer according to this new act is defined as a person who buys any good or avails any service, but not for the purposes of resale or for any other commercial interest. So, as an example, say you procure a good today and then you try to sell it at a profit tomorrow, you may not be defined as a consumer since it is for commercial interest. You are trying to make a profit out of it. So, this definition limits persons who are procuring good or availing service for their own personal consumption as consumers. Six consumer rights have been defined according to this new act, including the right to safety, right to be informed, right for the consumer to choose, right to be heard, which in this context means legal hearing, right to seek redressal, and the right to consumer education. So these are the six consumer rights defined in this new act. Moving on to the key aspects of the 2019 Consumer Protection Act. So the new act provides for the establishment of the Central Consumer Protection Authority. So this shall henceforth be abbreviated as CCPA, and the CCPA shall have powers to conduct investigations into violations of consumer rights and may institute complaints or prosecute on the basis of such violations. The CCPA also may order recall of unsafe goods and services and has the authority to order cessation of unfair trade practices and misleading advertisements. So this is a very key point in the new act. So according to the new act, the CCPA shall have the power to stop or cease the misleading advertisements and may hold both the manufacturer, the service provider, as well as the celebrity endorser accountable for such misleading advertisements. Say for example, someone claims that this said oil could even cure your hereditary baldness or some other absurd claim which is not actually possible, then such misleading advertisements can be held accountable and the CCPA may impose financial penalties of up to rupees 10 lakh on the first violation, and this amount may increase in subsequent violations of such misleading advertisements. Regarding product liability, the basis for product liability action according to the new act include manufacturing defects, design defects, deviation from the said manufacturing specifications, not conforming to the warranty period that was issued by the service provider or the seller, or failing to contain adequate instruction for correct use, that is in case of brochures or catalogs that is provided along with the equipment, and faulty, imperfect or deficient service provided. So these are the basis for initiating product liability action, and in case of one or more of these defaults, the manufacturer, product service provider or the product seller shall be held responsible to compensate for injury or otherwise damage that is caused by this defective product or the inadequate or imperfect or deficient service that was provided. An aspect of the new act that has received widespread appreciation is that e-commerce has now been included within the scope of the Consumer Protection Act, and henceforth all rules that apply to direct selling and direct sales providers shall also be applicable to e-commerce service providers. The Consumer Protection e-commerce rules of 2020 have been made mandatory, and so they are not advisories and are notified under the Consumer Protection Act. Another thing is that key information relating to the product and the purchase of the product are henceforth required to be provided to the customers by the e-commerce retailers. These include information relating to refund, grievance redressal mechanisms, security of payment methods, country of origin, and various other information. E-commerce establishments must now acknowledge filed complaints within 48 hours span of time and should also redress such complaints within 1 month span of time. Another thing that has been given under the new act is that the return policy that was previously applicable to direct sales providers have now been made applicable to e-commerce platforms as well. So, under this return policy, sellers cannot refuse to take back goods or withdraw services or refuse refunds in case that the good or service that they have provided are found to be defective, deficient, or delivered late. A key change with regards to e-commerce establishments is that the companies, that is the e-commerce companies, are now prohibited from manipulating the price of the good or service in order to gain unfair profit or advantage. Now, you would have noticed that in multiple e-commerce platforms, the maximum retail price, that is the MRP of the product, keeps on changing. Even within 1 week, you can see that the MRP keeps shifting from 100 to 150 to 200. So let's take an example. Say you are buying some product, let us say it is a watch, and the MRP is listed as 1000 rupees on Monday of this week, and then they change it to 2500 by Friday and then provide you 50% discount on that price. So now you will be getting the product at 1250, but the same product was given in 1000 rupees on Monday. So here it makes it appears as though you are getting the product at 50% discount, but actually you are paying 250 rupees more than you could have paid on Monday. So such kind of manipulation of the price has been prohibited. Since most consumer disputes are civil in nature and not of criminal, therefore alternate dispute resolution mechanisms have been provided. The 2019 Consumer Protection Act provides for mediation as an alternate dispute resolution mechanism, and the Act has also proposed such mediation cells to be attached to consumer commissions. The new Act also provides for referral to mediation within 5 days span of time of receiving due consent of the parties, that is, the involved parties being the consumer and the product manufacturer or seller. And the also, there cannot be any appeal against settlement through such mediation process. Previously, the adjudication process, that is the legal process associated with dealing with the consumer dispute, was said to be complicated. Hence, the new Act has attempted to simplify the adjudication process, and in accordance with that objective, the new Act has empowered the state and the district commissions to review their own orders. Also, the new Act enables customers or consumers to file complaints electronically, online or through phone call. It is expected that enabling electronic complaint registration will improve the complaint outcome, and hence people who were previously unable to file complaints can now file complaints electronically. Also, as far as the legal hearing process is concerned, video conferencing is also accepted as a method for hearing. Now, regarding the admissibility of complaints, if a person has filed a complaint and after 21 days, that is the stipulated time given for the concerned commission to decide on the admissibility of the complaint, if the commission has still not taken any decision, the complaint shall be default deemed admissible. That is, if after 21 days the commission still has not made any decision, by default, the complaint shall be deemed admissible. In accordance with the previous Consumer Protection Acts, it was required that if you have to make a complaint, the complaint should be filed at the location of purchase. So let's take an example. Say you are a resident of Chennai and you purchased a good in Bangalore, and after coming back to Chennai, you realize that something is faulty with the good you purchased. So if you want to file a complaint, you'll have to go back to Bangalore and file a complaint at the Bangalore Consumer Dispute Commission. Now, according to this new act, that is the 2019 act, complaints can now be made in the commissions where the complainant resides or works. So taking the same example, you can file a complaint in Chennai although you procured the good in Bangalore, since Chennai is the place you live and the place you work. The new act has also decided on the hearing authority based on the monetary value of dispute. So in case the monetary value of your dispute exceeds 10 crores, your hearing shall take place in the National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. So Consumer Dispute Redressal is abbreviated as CDR. In case of disputes valuing between 1 to 10 crores, It shall take place in a state CDR commission, Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. And for disputes valuing less than 1 crore, it shall take place in a district Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. Taking a brief look at the provisions for penalty in the new act. So, in case a person has been convicted for selling adulterated or spurious goods, in case of the first conviction, the new act states that the license shall be revoked for a time period of a maximum of 2 years. And in case of second or subsequent conviction, the license may be revoked permanently. Other than the above mentioned rules and regulations, the new act states that there shall be no fees charged for filing cases of monetary value of up to rupees 5 lakhs, and also the unclaimed amount due to unidentifiable consumers will go to the Consumer Welfare Fund. Hope you liked our video. Please leave your feedback in the form of comments, and please remember to subscribe to our channel. Thank you.